My name is Mindy Gruzin, and I grew up in foster care. Today, I'm a medical student and a mom. And that's a pretty big jump from there to here. And if you would have told me even 10 years ago that I'd be where I'm at today, I would have laughed at you. I am resilient, but I wasn't always. My mother was a single mom. She got sick when I was growing up. When I was 7, it was determined that she was no longer able to care for me, despite her best efforts. So I became a ward of the state of Maryland. I was born into a loving Jewish family. Yet I still wound up in the system. It was nobody's fault. That's just what happened. I spent the next 11 years in residential treatment centers, group homes, and foster homes. Just to give you a glimpse into the world of a so-called system kid, here's me at age 10. I was a pretty happy kid. Here I am posing during a game of Foursquare. We lived in a large facility called Villa Maria on a unit called Ambrose, which is kind of like a dorm. I collected stickers and pogs. I loved books and drawing. So I was a normal kid, but my life wasn't. It was super unstable. And when your life is unstable, you don't think about what might happen next. You don't plan for the future. You're in survival mode. So that was my life, and I didn't know anything else. One big theme of growing up that way is that so much was off limits, and that's just the way it was. Anyone here who's grown up in poverty can probably also relate to this. You don't ask for things, right? New clothes, the latest toy. For me, this extended to lots of other things. There were no after-school activities, no sports, no birthday parties, no sleepovers. I really like these LA lights. Remember these from the 90s? But I never considered that I'd have them, so I just kind of admired them. So as I grew into a teenager and a young adult, I never really asked myself those normal questions. Like, what else is there? What's possible for me? When I turned 18, I did what all system kids do eventually. I aged out and tried to survive on my own. Now when this happens, it's you versus world, no safety net. Many kids don't make it, and lots of kids I grew up with later wound up dead, in jail, or struggling with addiction. I was determined to make it, though, my definition of making it. My boyfriend and I got a little apartment in Park Heights, which is a rough area of Baltimore City, and I started working as a waitress. Now, even though I was technically free from the system, there was still so much that seemed automatically off limits. While many people my age were in college finding themselves, I was just trying to find enough money for food and to pay rent. When I found out I was pregnant, my boyfriend was in jail, so I told him over the phone. I wound up raising my son alone. Imagine a young mom with a baby in a tiny roach-infested apartment with bullets literally flying through the kitchen window and drug deals going on outside. It's hard to believe now, because I wouldn't even step foot in that neighborhood today. I'd be way too scared. But that was my life. That was my normal. I walked to the grocery store because I couldn't drive, only buying what I could fit underneath my son's stroller. To get to a doctor's appointment, I had to take 2 buses and a light rail, and if any of them were late, my appointment was canceled. So every little thing was needlessly hard. And this was a low point in my life because although I wanted more for us, I felt frozen with fear. And that's ironic, because I didn't fear my neighborhood or my circumstances. I feared change and instability. I was the antithesis of resilience. I'd always been interested in medicine and science, but of course, just like those LA lights, I didn't even consider college a possibility. And why would I? Who would watch my son? How would I pay for it? What even was the first step? At the time, I figured college was just another thing that was off limits for someone like me. I'm pausing here because, as you can see, I've arrived. The process of applying to medical school is a beast. Anyone who's ever done this, you already know. Secondary essays, writing that personal statement, even the most innocent prompt, like, tell us about a challenge you've overcome. Hello, My whole life has been a challenge I've overcome. So this whole process forced me to take a look at my weird past. In interviews, I was always asked, so what happened? What changed? As if there were some magic formula to my resilience. And I had a hard time answering this question because, honestly, I wasn't sure at the time. All I knew was that that change within me didn't happen overnight. It was gradual and deliberate, not a light switch on or off, or a sudden revelation. Now, ever since those interviews, I've kind of been haunted by that question. How did I become resilient? Now, there's a few common schools of thought when it comes to resilience. Some people think that you're born resilient, that you have inherent traits that make you able to withstand all life has to throw at you. And it's been suggested that some people may demonstrate physiological markers of resilience, such as differences in heart rate, blood pressure, stress hormones, and immune function. In lab settings, resilience is often tested in mice because their nervous systems are similar to humans. They subject the mice to what's called chronic social defeat stress, which involves putting a test mouse in a cage with an aggressive mouse for a few minutes each day, and then separating them with a clear partition. But that test mouse can still see the aggressive mouse. Now, after 10 days, most test mice start acting depressed, but a third of these mice don't. And these mice are called resilient. Christophe et al. Was the first to show that they have more glutamine synapse remodeling. And that's important because glutamine is what a lot of our brain signals are made of. Hashmati et al. Found that resilient mice had a threefold difference in global gene expression and more dopamine signaling in their brains. That's the reward signal. In a human twin study, Alexandra Vasquez found that academically and socially resilient people had enhanced expression of genes related to DNA repair and cognitive development pathways. So maybe something biological is going on when it comes to resilience. But the problem I have with this theory is, if that's all there is to it, that's discouraging. Because it would mean that some lucky people are born resilient, and everyone else is destined to languish in their misfortune. It would also mean that you can't learn or teach resilience. Given that there are people like myself who have learned to be resilient, I'm not convinced that biology is all there is to it. Then there's that theory that what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, that just by going through a difficult ordeal, that will somehow make you resilient. And that sounds good, that sounds empowering, and that may be true for some people. But then how do you explain this? The CDC conducts what are called ACE studies. ACE stands for Adverse Childhood Experiences. These are potentially traumatic events that occur in childhood, like violence, neglect, and parental absence. ACEs are linked to chronic health problems, mental illness, and substance abuse in adulthood. Actually, for every ACE you have, your risk increases by orders of magnitude for things like teen pregnancy, financial problems, smoking, perpetuating or perpetrating domestic violence, and even early death. ACEs are breathtakingly common. 61% of adults in the U.S. report at least one ACE, and one in six report four or more ACEs. Wow. So, I would argue that what you go through often hurts you. To say it always makes you stronger, that minimizes the very real effects of trauma. So if we're not necessarily born with it, and it's not hardened into us by a tough life, how do people become resilient? I'm a Capricorn, so here's a mountain goat. Did you know these guys can climb up to 13,000 feet at inclines as steep as 60 degrees? They do this to escape predators, so they're safer higher up in the mountain than they would be if they stayed comfortable down in the valley. Now, they're not very fast, but they do have powerful legs and grippy hooves for climbing. But I also imagine they don't worry too much about how tall the mountain is or how long it's going to take to climb it. They just worry about their next step. They stick their little hoof out and they figure out where it's safe to latch on. And slowly, they ascend the mountain. When I realized I desperately wanted to go to college, I was already 27. I'd worked hard to become a medical assistant and stabilize my life. The idea of becoming unstable again was terrifying. To go back to school to become a doctor, of all things, seemed like climbing Mount Everest naked. And that's how things seem when you spent your whole life in the valley. Now, most of you have heard of this strategy of breaking a big task into smaller, more manageable chunks. And that's all well and good if we're talking about something low stakes, like a project at work or cleaning out your garage. In my case, I had a whole mountain, so even the chunks seemed like mini mountains. Now, I knew what I wanted, but I was getting frustrated by my own inaction. So, I did what the goats do. I asked, what's the first step? The step before enrolling in community college was going to open house night. Yes, I'm going to recite a poem. Open house night. But even that seemed too big at the time. Working full time, raising a kid on my own. Okay, go smaller. Maybe just asking my coworker if she'd watch my then 5-year-old son so I could go. But I was worried she'd say no, so my actual first step, and this may seem really silly, was to get my butt up off the chair and walk over to her office. I thought, yeah, I'm capable of just that tiny, deliberate act. So I walked over, and after a few awkward moments of standing in her doorway, she was like, can I help you? So I asked, and she said yes. And just like that, the ball was rolling. The door was open. It was like a gateway act, walking over there, because it meant I had to ask. And if she said yes, I had to go to open house night. That tiny, deliberate act wasn't so scary or overwhelming. It was a ridiculously small step, but it was what I needed to break my personal inertia. So I approached the rest of my journey like this. Every time I felt afraid, I scaled back to the tiniest step I felt comfortable starting with. Now, don't get me wrong. This strategy was never meant to be a cure for the self-doubt and fear that I still experience. My barriers were still there. I still had to work much harder than the next student. But every time those small, deliberate acts added up to a small accomplishment, I felt empowered. Gradually, I started to believe that my next step had better odds of success. And maybe I didn't need to break them down into these microscopic bits anymore. Based on experience. Based on resilience. This was how I personally became resilient. Through tiny, deliberate acts. I graduated summa cum laude with a bachelor's degree from Penn State York in May 2020. And last fall, matriculated to Geisinger Commonwealth School of Medicine on a full ride scholarship in the middle of a pandemic. Like, what? Thank you. The first day I walked into this building as a student, MD class of 2024, I felt resilient, because I was. I checked out my reflection in the front door in my white coat and recognized that I was transformed. And every so often, I still get stuck. Life comes for you at every age and stage, but I know that resilience is an ongoing journey which requires maintenance. And it's in the need to work at it, the fact that we can work at it, that's where there's hope for anyone feeling less than resilient right now. So if I'm right, and I could certainly be wrong, but if I'm right, and we entertain the idea that one way to build resilience is with these tiny deliberate acts, how can we use this approach to help others? As of now, science has left the particulars of human resilience kind of undefined. Here's what I think about it. I think resilience is a trait that's accessible inside each and every one of us. Many of us face added barriers which present real challenges to our own resilience, social inequity, disability, poverty. My own privilege as a white, well-spoken US citizen does not escape me. And I live with survivor's guilt, asking myself why I'm okay. And so many of the kids I grew up with have poor outcomes. I don't know the answers to that question. But I do know that I was very nearly in the same boat. And the only thing between me and a lifetime of hardship were these tiny, deliberate acts that changed my life, my self-concept, and my resilience. As a student doctor, I need to know how this might help patients who, through no fault of their own, will have very real barriers which keep them from tapping into their resilience. Lack of insurance, poor health literacy, lack of advocacy, lack of trust, a racist health system, a broken health system. Barriers add up. They paralyze us. They affect our perception of what we think we can achieve. They wear our resilience down to a nub. The bigger the mountain seems, the more likely we are to believe we're just not built to climb it. Let's challenge that idea today, right now. We know when patients feel like they have a partnership with their providers, they have better health outcomes. But how do we teach resilience? Maybe we should stop telling people about their mountains. They already know about their mountains. Maybe we should stop reciting to patients that they should simply just quit smoking, eat healthier, exercise, better manage a chronic condition. What if instead we partnered with our patients and helped them whittle their own mountains into tiny, deliberate steps? What if we kept going smaller and smaller until we found what the patient feels capable of and used that act to help them break their inertia and build resilience over time? What if